Everybody, it is really good to be able to worship together as part of the body of Christ, to come together like this. This is our pre-Thanksgiving service, and so we get to focus on things that we are thankful for and grateful for. You know, if there's things in your life you're like, I just don't know. I don't know what I'm thankful for. Well, there's a lot to be thankful for, especially when we look at the fact that God is a good God. And regardless of the fact that a lot of times we mess up and we do things and we kind of get off the path, but God is always good and he's always merciful. And he forgives our sins and he gives us eternal life regardless of all of those things. And so we should be thankful and grateful for those things. And so to kick off our service this morning, Katara is going to share a scripture with us.
Good morning. Our scripture this morning comes from Ezra. It is chapter 3, verse 11. With praise and thanksgiving, they sang to the Lord, he is good. His love toward Israel endures forever. And all the people gave a great shout of praise to the Lord because the foundation of the house of the Lord was laid.
Amen. Well, let's stand together, lift our voices together this morning, and sing some songs of praise, gratitude.
Now you're
Amen. Lord, help us to give thanks every day for all the things that you've done for us, Lord. Just always be grateful in our hearts and to sing the joy that comes with knowing you. We give you this time, Lord, in Jesus' name.
Love that song. Please be seated. One of the great, great things about being part of a church family is sharing high and holy moments together. And one of those high and holy moments is the sacrament of Christian baptism. Different denominations have different traditions on how they do baptism, but the point is the same. It's a sacrament, which means it's a symbol. But also, it's one of the ways that God pours more of his grace into you, one of the ways you connect with God. You remember in the song we just sang, we were praising our triune God. Praise God the Father, and God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. And a very unusual incident in the book of Acts, Paul meets some believers on the outskirts of town. And he said, have you believed in the Holy Spirit since you believed in Christ? And they said, no, we haven't even heard that there is a Holy Spirit, which I take as evidence that United Methodists were in the book of Acts there. But Paul answered them. He said, then how were you baptized? Because we baptize people in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. And it's a symbol in the sense that a wedding ring is a symbol. Now, you probably know, like I know a few people, who in our culture, for whatever reason, choose not to wear wedding rings. They're married. They're very married. They're committed to their marriage. But for whatever reason, they don't wear a wedding ring. It doesn't make them unmarried. They just don't use that symbol because it's the commitment that seals a marriage. In the same way, we are saved by our commitment to Jesus Christ. Years ago, John and Shannon Thomas made that commitment to Jesus Christ. But for a variety of reasons, they have not gone through the sacrament of holy baptism. And they come now to do that. So John and Shannon, would you stand up here, please? They both accepted Christ. Stand right here and turn around so they can see you. They both accepted Christ when they were older children. Interestingly enough, John, on Halloween, which would have been interesting if we'd done this last week on Halloween, but they gave their life to Christ then, but they're just now coming for baptism because this is the first church that they're officially joining. And so I have these formal questions for you, which we've talked about before. The first one is this: do you truly and earnestly repent of your sins and accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior? Do you? Do you then believe in God the Father, Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, His only Son, our Lord, and in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life? Do you? Do you desire to be baptized as a Christian? Do you? Will you then obediently keep God's holy will and His commandments and walk in these all the days of your life? Will you? With God's help. Amen. Would you please kneel there? Shannon, Leah, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. John Ivan, I baptize you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Would you please stand? Let's give them a hand here. And now you all have a big part of this. You represent the church worldwide all throughout history, and we have a community of faith. So let me ask you, brothers and sisters of the household of faith, I commend to your love and care John and Shannon, whom we have just recognized as members of the family of God. Will you endeavor so to live that they may grow in their knowledge and love of God the Father through our Lord Jesus Christ? Will you? With God's help, we will so order our lives after the example of Christ that, surrounded by steadfast love, you may be established in the faith and confirmed and strengthened in the way that leads to life eternal. Amen. Let's pray for them. Father, I thank you for where you brought John and Shannon and their boys. And Father, I thank you for what you have in store for them. Lord, we ask your protection on them and their family in every way that they need. We ask your guidance for them by the Holy Spirit in every decision that they have to make. And Father, most of all, we ask your Holy Spirit to continue to grow in them and flow out of them into the lives of many, many others. We ask, Father, that they would not only be great disciples, but as you say, they would become great disciple makers in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Great. Thanks so much. Let's give them another hand. One thing that I meant to tell you is you noticed we did the form of baptism of sprinkling. Different traditions do baptism differently. We recognize all three, and they have different symbols. Sprinkling symbolizes the washing away of your sin by the blood of Jesus Christ. Pouring, which is actually the oldest evidence that we have, symbolizes the pouring of God's Holy Spirit into your life. And then immersion symbolizes you die to yourself and you're raised anew in Christ. And of course, the amount of water is not crucial. What's crucial is the commitment of your heart. And so I just want to use that for a teaching moment here. As we go to prayer, there are several things that we need to be praying for. First of all, our ministry partners that we're going to be praying for today. One is St. Paul Baptist Church and their pastor, Jerry C. And the other ministry partner is Authentic Renovation Ministry, headed up by Gary Wendt, that does roof repairs and wheelchair ramps and different construction ministry for people in town. He's one of our oldest partners. Also, you need to know Rick Marshall had heart surgery this week that went well. And Bill Matchin, Ben's dad, is going to have a surgical procedure later this week. We also need to be praying for those who have lost family members lately. As you know, as you get into the holidays, that can be a very difficult time. So would you please pray with me? Heavenly Father, by the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, who died for us, who rose from the grave for us, in his name we come before your great throne of power and love and grace and mercy. And Father, we ask that your power and your love would extend to these situations of people that we love and we know that you love. Father, particularly we lift up those who have lost family members recently. Would you help them this week as they get into the holidays? Would you help them grieve? Grieve deeply, grieve well, but grieve with hope in the resurrection of our Lord Jesus. Father, we ask your full recovery for Rick Marshall as he comes out of surgery and Bill Matchin as he goes in to surgery. And Lord, also for Mike Griffin from Arbor Springs Baptist, would you bring full miraculous healing to Brother Mike as he recovers from this wreck a few weeks ago. Lord, we also lift up to you St. Paul Baptist. Would you bless that congregation? Would you bless Jerry C. as he leads it and all the leadership, the deacons there? Lord, we ask they would go deeper with you, that they would grow broader in ministry and larger in their congregation, that they would reach more and more people for the kingdom of Jesus. And Father, we ask your blessings on Gary Wendt as he runs Authentic Renovation Ministry. Would you provide him all the resources that he needs? Father, I thank you for your hand on him and how he's blessed so many people in this area through that ministry. Father, finally, we continue to ask you for revival in our nation, in our community, and in our own hearts. Lord, would you bring us to the place of brokenness and obedience and surrender that we might open the door for your presence here? And Lord, in this week, in Thanksgiving, would you draw us, Father, to have an increased lifestyle of gratitude and appreciation? We ask this in the name and for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Can we stand as we sing?
So
take me home, where joy shall fill my heart. Then I shall bow in humble adoration, and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to me, how great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul,
your word, Lord. I just pray that you'll use him as a vessel to let us hear what you have to say, Lord. We just love you and thank you. In Christ's name and sake, amen.
Let's, 1, 2, 3. We good here? We had to swap mics out because we were having some problems. Thank you, great tech team. They had a lot of issues this morning that none of us ever see, but they worked through, and we couldn't get online the first service, but they got us online the second service. And Chris has been battling a bug all morning. He just toughed through to lead two great worship services. It's amazing the things that go on that we never see here because our people just handle it. This is, of course, Thanksgiving week that we are coming up to. And it's so easy to skip over the true meaning of Thanksgiving. Honestly, though, of all the holidays, I think this is maybe my favorite. The others seem to be so commercialized, particularly Christmas. Thanksgiving seems to be a little more pure. And the root of it, the heart of it, the meaning of it is so biblical. And it's so helpful to our lives. Giving thanks, having a lifestyle of gratitude. This last week, actually Friday, our oldest granddaughter had a little surgical procedure done on her ear up in Nashville. And she asked if KK and granddad could come up for the surgery. Really difficult decision there. So we went up, and the day before we took her out to her favorite little place to eat. And I thought she was acting a little funny when she went over to the potato chip rack and asked if she could have some potato chips. I said, sure, maybe you can eat some potato chips. Well, we didn't know that mom and dad did not let her have those potato chips. She was scamming granddad, which was easy. But when we sat down at the table and we opened up the bag, the first thing she did was reached in and grabbed a potato chip and reached across the table and said, here, granddad, you want a potato chip. And granddad's heart just melted that she was hopefully developing a heart of gratitude. God tells us, he instructs us, he commands us to do that, to have a lifestyle of gratitude. Why? Because he needs his head puffed up? No, of course not. Because it's right and it blesses us. He tells, or he told, his people, the Hebrews, back in the Old Testament, instructed them and gave them specific reminders to have a lifestyle of gratitude. One of those we're going to look at here, if you have your Bibles or your Bible app, flip open to Joshua chapter 4. If you're not sure where Joshua is, start at Genesis. It's the sixth book of the Bible. We go through Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, then Joshua. So it's pretty early in the Bible. Chapter 4. You remember the Hebrews are just about to finally come into the land of Israel, the promised land. And they get right on the edge, and God gives them a reminder. A reminder that will go on for generation to generation of what he has done for them. We pick it up there in Joshua chapter 4, verse 4. I'm reading out of the NIV. So Joshua called together the 12 men that he had appointed from the Israelites, one from each tribe, and said to them, go over before the ark of the Lord your God into the middle of the Jordan River. Each of you is to take up a stone on his shoulder according to the number of the tribes of the Israelites to serve as a sign among you. In the future, when your children ask you, what do these stones mean? You tell them that the flow of the Jordan River was cut off before the Ark of the Covenant of the Lord. When it crossed the Jordan River, the waters of the Jordan were cut off. These stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel for the next 3 days, for the next 3 centuries, forever, you're to remember. So let's pray. Heavenly Father, we ask your Holy Spirit now to speak into our hearts and souls and spirits. And that this will be a new beginning of a new chapter in our lives to develop this quality higher than it's ever been that you tell us about gratitude and thanksgiving. Father, we ask this in the name and for the glory of our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. You remember the background to this story, don't you? The family of Jacob, who was renamed Israel, was living in this area of the country we now call Israel, named for him. And there was infighting in the family. The other peoples around them didn't like them. They were really on the brink, on the risk of annihilation. God's holy people, after Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and his 12 sons, it was looking tenuous. So God took them down to Egypt. One of his sons, Joseph, was there. He was prime minister. And for the next 400 years, they lived there. Now, part of that time, they lived well. But the Egyptians started getting fearful of them, so they subjugated them into slavery for several hundred years. So they grew into a great nation. And God said, okay, it's time for my people to finally go back to the land that I promised them. And with a mighty, powerful hand, God put plague after plague on Egypt because the Pharaoh didn't want to let the Jews go. They had free labor. And finally, when it came to the next person in line to have a plague was going to be Pharaoh, Pharaoh said, okay, they can go. So God led them out, went to the Red Sea, and Pharaoh changed his mind, sent his army after them. God split the Red Sea open. The Israelites, the Hebrews, went over on dry land. The army from Egypt tried to follow him, and he closed them back over. He protected them miraculously, delivered them out of Egypt miraculously, led it by a column of fire at night and a big cloud during the day, led them exactly where to go to Mount Sinai, gave them the Ten Commandments. The greatest, most concise moral teaching ever given on the planet by the hand of God. If the Hebrews had just kept those 10 rules, history would be very different. Then again, if we kept those 10 rules, our lives would be very different, wouldn't they? They complain about not having food. God sent manna every day. Didn't have to work for it. Didn't have to work. They just go gather up the manna. They complained. Don't have enough meat. God sent quail. So much. I'm convinced God is a southerner. Fried quail. Sent them so much quail, it was coming out their noses. They were so stuffed with it. God, they complained about no water. God brought water from a rock to water however many million Hebrews there were. Still, they disobeyed. God said, okay, I've had enough of it. This generation is not going to get into the promised land. For 40 years, you guys are going to wander around here in the desert until this generation dies out. I'll take your kids in when they grow up. So after 40 years, we're finally at the brink. The only thing that lays between the Hebrews and the promised land is the River Jordan, which, by the way, is not near as big as Black Warrior. It's what we call the stream. And they're right there at the brink, but it's flood stage. And God says, look, before you guys go in, I know what you're like. You're going to forget. You're going to forget all the things that I've done for you. Back in Egypt, over the last 40 years, the countries I've protected you from, the manna, the quail, the water, all the ways I've provided. So we need to set up a memory post called a memorial. Been to Washington, D.C.? It is filled with memorials. Well, this was a memorial for Israel. He said, just like I split the Red Sea open 40 years ago, I'm going to do a similar thing here with the Jordan River. I'm going to cut off the flow. And you don't even have to ford the river during flood stage. You can go over on dry land like you went across the Red Sea on dry land. But I want you to remember. So in the middle of the river, take up 12 stones, one for each of the tribes of the country, and set it up on the far bank so that when your kids and your grandkids' grandkids walk by the riverbank here, say, Granddaddy, what's that pile of rocks for? You tell them. You tell them so that they'll remember all the things that I did for you. These stones are to be a memorial to the people of Israel forever so that they can remember and give thanks. Why does God want us to give thanks? In fact, do you know one of the most common phrases in all the Old Testament is give thanks to the Lord, for he is good. His love endures forever. Think about that phrase. Give thanks to the Lord. Why? Because he's good. Can you imagine what your life would be like if God wasn't good? If he was evil? If he was vindictive? If he was mean-spirited? If he was petty like we are? Can you imagine what the universe would be like if that was his character? My goodness. We always think of the goodness of God, but what if there was the badness of God, the meanness of God? When we think about the fact that our God is good, unlike every other God of every other religion, should we give thanks without stopping? But it didn't stop there. Give thanks to the Lord because he's good. And his love endures how long? Forever. God loves us. Why? I don't have an answer to you for that. I don't know why he would love us, except that's his character. Praise God, it's his character. Folks, if we get a handle on that he's good and he's love and he loves us and he always does things for our good, we continually give thanks and praise to him. But there are a couple more reasons that we need to give thanks. Number one, it sets our relationship with him right. One of my mentors talked about McDonaldland's religion. You know, when you pull up to order at McDonald's, you give them your order and say, make it snappy. I want what I want, and I want it quickly. And a lot of us treat God like that. God, here's what I want, and would you please hurry it up and do it exactly the way I want. I don't want my order messed up. That is not how we come to God. God is the almighty God of the universe. We're not. So when we come to him with thanksgiving, it sets the relationship right. He's the creator, we're the created. He's the king, we're his subjects. He's the father, we're the children. Giving thanks helps to get the order right. Jesus hints at this in the Lord's Prayer, how it begins. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. We start praising and thanking him, not giving him our order and telling him to make it snappy. Another reason, though, is that when we give thanks, when we learn to be grateful, do you know who's blessed more than anybody else? Us. Think about the meanest, most miserable people that you know. It's all about them, isn't it? They're not grateful for anything. Anything you try to do for them is never enough. Know anybody like that? They haven't developed a heart of gratitude. And the other side of the coin is true, too. The nicest people you know, the ones who are most content, the most pleasant, what comes out of their mouth almost continually? Thank you. And you know they really mean it. It comes from their heart. When we develop a heart of gratitude, it blesses us. It's one of the reasons that God told the Israelites to remember what he did for them and develop a heart of gratitude. Now, this week is Thanksgiving. It's all about this subject, isn't it? How did Thanksgiving even get started? Let's go back with a little history lesson. In the 1500s, there was a large group of people in the church in Europe that said, wait a minute, the church is not doing right. They're not doing what the Bible says. We're going to protest how the church is acting, and we want to reform it. And so they had what they called the Protestant Reformation, led by a Greek Catholic monk named Martin Luther. And it spread throughout Europe and the rest of the world. And people started saying, wait a minute, we want to worship God the way the Bible says, not the way the Catholic Church says. And so they started a Lutheran Church, Presbyterian Church, and the Church of England. The king started the Church of England there. And in the next century, in the 1600s, some of the Christians there, particularly in a little village called Scrooby, I didn't make that up, said, wait a minute, the Church of England is doing the same thing that the Catholic Church was trying to do in the last century. They're trying to tell us how to have a relationship with the Heavenly Father. We're not going to do that. We want to worship God the way we think the Bible says. And the King of England said, not in this country, you're not. You're going to do it my way. So they left and they went to Holland for a few years. Didn't work out well there. So they came back and they said, okay, we're going to take the big plunge. We're going to go across the ocean to the ends of the earth, to this new place called North America, and worship God there. It's said that the Spaniards came to America seeking gold. Pilgrims came to America seeking God so they could worship God the way that they saw fit. So 102 people got on the Mayflower, about the size of a volleyball court, maybe, and set off across the ocean. Can you imagine that? Think of this now, in our current day. You get on a spaceship to go to another galaxy, and you will never again see your family. You'll never see Earth again. But you're willing to do that so you can get off somewhere away from control so you can worship God the way you see fit. These people were serious. and they were tough. Halfway across the Atlantic Ocean, bad storm hit them. The main mast broke, just snapped. William Bradford, the historian of the Mayflower, said they had a big decision, life-altering decision, whether to go on or to go back. They said they prayed, they committed themselves to the hands of the Lord, they tried to winch the mast back up, and they went forward. Reaching the northeast coast of America, around Massachusetts, in November 1620, their charter was to sail on down to Jamestown, Virginia. But each time they tried it, a south wind came back and blew them back into the Massachusetts Bay Area. They literally, physically could not sail down to where they were supposed to be. They said, we've got to land somewhere. We're running out of stores here. And so they sent a foray onto the land, and they came across a native village that was deserted. There was a store of corn there, but there were no people mysteriously. So they decided to land there. What they didn't know, actually several things they didn't know. Number one, had they sailed down to Jamestown, Jamestown was on the brink of starvation themselves. There was no way they could have had enough food for them and the pilgrims that winter of 1620, 1621. The second thing they didn't realize is that most of the native tribes along that coast were hostile and did not want the Europeans there. The third thing was the coming winter of 20 and 21 was a particularly hard, difficult winter. Historians now realize that probably the only spot on the whole eastern seaboard that they could have landed and survived that winter at all was the exact spot on what we now call Plymouth Colony. What had happened is that a plague had swept through the Patuxent tribe and wiped them out. The only thing that was left was their housing and the store of corn that they had laid up for the winter. What did the pilgrims survive on that winter? The store of corn. How coincidental, do you think? The pilgrims that winter got down to 5 kernels of corn per person per day. Out of the 102, 47 of them did not survive that first winter. 16 out of 18 of the wives died. But not one of the daughters died. Which group of people was it that was crucial for the propagation of the colony there? It was the daughters to give birth to future children. Interestingly enough, both Chris Green and Kara Green had ancestors that were in that group of pilgrims. Her name was Priscilla, what? Priscilla Mullins Alden, yeah, came across. Her family died on the voyage. She survived, and she was one of the daughters that survived that winter of 1620, 1621. I'm really glad she survived, Kara. But why did they, so the other piece of the story is that spring, a Patuxent Indian walked into his home village, a man named Tisquantum. You may know him as Squanto. He had been kidnapped years earlier by European fishermen, sold as a slave in Europe, spent years there. During some of that time, he had lived with, probably owned by, a Catholic monk who had told him about Jesus, told him about the gospel. And Tisquantum had accepted Christ into his heart. He got his freedom, made his way back to his homeland, only to find the village wiped out. He was living kind of in the region, and when he heard there were Christian believers living in his old village, he went back that spring. And it was Tisquantum that taught him how to plant an effective way, how to hunt in the areas. And that that year of 1621, they had an unusually good harvest. And so in the fall of the year, they had a decision what to do. They had survived the first year. They had laid up stores for the winter. How were they going to react? Were they going to pat themselves on the back, congratulate one another on their good luck and their resourcefulness and their hard work? What a foolish thing to do. Rather, they decided on the wise course of action. They set aside a time to give thanks to the one who had obviously blown their ship back into the only spot where they could survive, provided corn that they did not plant and they did not reap, provided safety for their children, particularly their daughters, and provided a guide to help them learn how to live off the land. So they set aside the first Thanksgiving celebration. And they invited a friendly native tribe, the Wampanoag Indians, with Chief Massasoit, to come over and join them. And so this week, we continue that tradition. How do you react when things go well? Let me ask you first, how do you react when things go badly? It's easy when we're down, when we're desperate, to pray, isn't it? All of you who've been in the military know that there is no atheist in a what? Foxhole, that's right. No atheist in a foxhole. When things are critical, it's easy to cry out to God. What about when things are good? Do you thank God as quickly, as readily, as you ask him for help? This week, we've set aside Thanksgiving. Every president has acknowledged Thanksgiving. President Lincoln made it an official holiday. What are you going to do on Thanksgiving? Well, our tradition is to give ourselves to gluttony, right? It's really fun. A lot of really good food. To gather with family, that's really good. Watch football, that's good, depending on who your team is. And we'll do all those things, and all those things are good. The question is that all you will do? God has commanded us to thank him. We're commanded to thank God. Why? Because he needs his head puffed up? No, because we need to learn how to give thanks. It blesses us more than it blesses anybody else. More than it blesses him. He tells us to give thanks because it's for our good, and it sets our relationship with him right. And it makes us the best version of ourselves. During this week of food and football and family, are you also going to give thanks? And how will you do that? Let me suggest, if you haven't already started something like this, to write down at least three things every day that you're thankful for. Start keeping a list of that. And sometime later in the week, share it with someone. You might want to use it for your conversation around the Thanksgiving meal table. Some people, I know, put 5 kernels of corn in front of each plate. And what they do is pass a basket around. You put 1 kernel in there and share with everybody something you're thankful to God for. And so you have 5 trips around the table. You don't have to do it that way. But let me urge you, let me challenge you to start writing down daily things that you're thankful for. You see, the point of Thanksgiving is not to just have a big meal once a year. Thanksgiving is a reminder to create a lifestyle of gratitude. Paul writes, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. How can you possibly give thanks for everything? Is everything good? No, not everything is good. But the Bible says, in all things, God does work for the good to those who love him and are called according to his purpose. It's up to you. Do you want to live your life miserable and discontent? Or do you want to live your life with joy and contentment? How do you switch from here to there? How do you up your batting average, your percentage over here? Develop a heart of gratitude and thanksgiving. God commands it, not just for his good, but for our good. Then let me invite you, make this Thanksgiving a turning point in your life to up your level of gratitude, appreciation, and true thanksgiving. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for the cross. Lord Jesus, thank you for coming, for dying for us, the resurrection. God, thank you that you're good. God, thank you that you love us and that that endures forever. You don't change that depending on what we're doing at the time. Holy Spirit, would you please work in us to create more and more a lifestyle of appreciation, thanksgiving, of gratitude, and I thank you for what it does in our hearts. And Lord, would you help us right now? Would you prick our memories to start on that list of things that we can give thanks to you for? We ask this in the name of our Lord Jesus. While Suzanne plays here, let's take a few moments of prayer. You're welcome to stay at your seat. You're welcome to come up here to the altar. But let's start on just thanking God for some of his blessings to us. Thanks, Suzanne. Well, we want to welcome those of you who are new to Christ Harbor, either here in the room or joining us online. We apologize that we could not get things up online in the first service, but we're so glad that you joined us here in this second service. And we would like to connect with you if you're new to Christ Harbor. The best way to do that is either download the Christ Harbor app or go online to our website and click through the connect button. Ask any questions you want. Give us any information. Give us prayer requests. You can give financially. You can download sermon notes. There are a lot of things that you can do online there. Also, thank you all for those who brought your shoeboxes back. Those are actually due in about 30 minutes, and we're going to carry those off. The next thing that we have, if you would like to be a part of it, is the senior Christmas, let me get this right, Adopt a Senior, that Debbie Gregory's agency is doing. There's several seniors here in the community that just are not going to get any gifts for Christmas. Her agency tries to see that they do that. If you would like to pick out a senior or more than one, yes, sir? They're all what? They're all gone. Early bird gets a worm, y'all ain't. Sorry. So we can scratch that. Y'all don't have the chance to be nice. Actually, why don't we use that? Just ask God if there's somebody that he would put in your path that you can bless this Christmas and let him know It's because Jesus loves them. Didn't have to be a senior. Didn't have to be a child on the other side of the world. It could be somebody here in our neighborhood. Just ask him to let you know who that is. Also, next Sunday begins a season of Advent, the four Sundays leading up to Christmas when we prepare our hearts again to receive our Lord into the earth. As part of that, we're going to have an Advent candle that a different family will light. We've got next week already filled, but if you and your family would like to do the Advent candle in one of the future weeks, if you please let me know, I'll get you the information. I would love to have you to do that. And beginning next week, we're going to do a sermon series on how God showed his love to us through Advent. And so I invite you please to come back and bring some folks with you. Would you please stand now for the benediction? And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, may the love of God our Father, and may the fellowship and communion and guidance and power of the Holy Spirit be with you now, this week, and for eternity. Amen. God bless you. Have a great week.